All right, everybody get some lunch. Well, keep it rolling so food coma doesn't set in on you. Unlike eating and then sitting, right? So I'll share with you, before we move forward here real quick, one of my favorite lunch stories is, most of you know, if you've done with travel teams or whatever, sometimes those bus rides are important. You need to know where to stop. Well, when you're riding the bus in the minor leagues, those bus drivers know every single spot along the way. So we had a bus trip from Springfield, Massachusetts, and we were going all the way up to play the Fredericton Canadians and then St. John and those guys at that point. And our bus driver knew of a place in Portland he wanted to stop. So he pulls off at Melissa Gilbert's Roadhouse or Chart House. It was a small little restaurant, but for some of you might know Melissa Gilbert, the name from Little House on the Prairie and that stuff, right? Okay. So we pull in there, and they are not prepared for a busload of hockey players to come in. They manage it okay, though, so everybody's sitting down. And when you're in the minors, you know, you do more than just broadcast. You do PR. You do help, you know, set up the hotels and do the travel stuff as well. So you're just kind of sitting there, and you make sure everybody's set. So we're sitting there. Everybody's good. This hockey player, who I'll keep his name out of it, was a former first-round pick of the Phoenix Coyotes. I don't know if they gave him the Wunderlich test. And here's why. So he comes back. Apparently he orders his food. He comes back. He goes to the bathroom, and he comes and he sits down. The food is sitting right in front of him. And he looks at the other four guys at the table. And he looks at him and he says, "Hey, fellas, where's the rest of my food?" And they looked at him like, "What are you, nuts? You know, it's right in front of you." And he goes, "Seriously, guys, where's the rest of my food?" Now, for those that don't know the Northeast, once you hit Portland, and if you're going up to Fredericton, pretty much outside of Portland, you got nothing but wilderness, you know, for the next 6 hours, you know, all the way up. So you got a long ride. And so guys are pretty much storing food in their stomachs like a squirrel. And he's looking at this, going, "Hey, where's the rest of my food?" And this goes on for a couple minutes. Now he's getting mad, and he's starting to make a scene. So I look over to him, and then, "Hey, you're starting to kind of embarrass everybody here. Calm down. What the heck is the problem?" He says, "Look, we got 6 hours. I want to know where the rest of my food is." And I said, "Well, what'd you order?" And he says, "I ordered the ham and cheese special." And he points to the sandwich board. "Half ham and cheese, cup of soup." And I said, "You have a half ham and cheese and a cup of soup sitting in front of you. What's the problem?" I can't make this up. This is a true story. He actually thought that half the sandwich would be ham, half the sandwich would be cheese. You put it together, you've got your whole sandwich. And he was good. So he nearly started a fight there, and needless to say, he did. I don't know that he played a game for the Coyotes. Like I said, those Wunderlich tests. So we could have Barry Smith up here talking about hockey sense and hockey IQ, but there are certain other levels of questions maybe we should ask some guys and give them a sandwich menu. All right, couple of quick announcements. Remember, again, today's the last day for you to get the officials' warehouse gear downstairs. So if you haven't done that and you want it, they are not selling that stuff tomorrow, so make sure you get that today. And then for the purpose of, since they're videoing these, again, those question cards that we have, as much as I do kind of enjoy the interaction that we had, they've asked that you write your questions down on here so I can read them, so those questions go out on the video as well, which is going to be kind of important. So I'll tell you what we'll do. Like, I mean, you know the guests that are coming up. Just write your question down, slide it down to this end of the table, pass it like an old note in class, and then as Peter's finishing up, I'll come down and just get all the questions, and we'll do the questions that way again. So if you think of the question, grab those cards out and write them down. Okay, well, let's get going here. It's a pleasure to introduce our next speaker to you. Peter Laviolette is entering his third season as the head coach of the Nashville Predators, a guy that's just kind of come up through the ranks of the American League in Providence, you know, ended up with the New York Islanders after a stint as an assistant in Boston, now, of course, won a Stanley Cup with the Carolina Hurricanes, also head coach of the Philadelphia Flyers, and now in the Central Division, which, holy smokes, and now with Bruce Boudreau coming into this Central Division, the level of coaching in the Central Division on top of just the level of play is just going to be absolutely fantastic. But for those that don't know and have followed him more on the coaching side, you're also talking about a playing career that features a couple of Olympic trips as a player as well. So let's bring up your next speaker, NHL head coach Peter Laviolette.
Thank you. It's good to be here. Nice to be here. feel welcomed and looking forward to the opportunity of speaking to everybody here today. So thanks for having me. I was watching those videos that were just playing before I got up there, and you see all the skill development. It just reminded me as I'm here that I'm speaking to coaches of all ages. Could be Mike coaches, development coaches, intro to hockey, peewees, college, squirt, semi-pro, pro. So it was a wide range of people that I'm speaking to. And I was watching the kids up there, reminded me of my kids. And made me think to ask a quick question is, as a coach, I have two boys that play hockey. Is it easier coaching a team, or is it easier trying to coach your kids? How many think it's easier to try and coach your team as opposed to your kids? Okay. I got to tell you a quick story. So I was in Carolina, and we didn't make the playoffs, and my wife had booked a cruise for our family, and we hadn't been away on a vacation in a while. And so when the cruise took off, it came out a week later that the tryouts for the AAA hockey team were going to be in Raleigh, and we needed to be there. And so I called and I said, listen, I said, I can't get out of this cruise. I said, what's the process if somebody can't be there? And he said, well, you got to write a letter, and they'll set up an appointment on the AA tryout. They'll hold one spot, and then everybody will try out, and you'll go back, and they'll pick one kid out of the AA tryout, and that kid will make the AAA team. So I wrote the letter, went about the process, and we got back from the cruise, and it was the AA tryout. So there was 99 kids trying out. 98 were trying to make two teams, and one person was going to make the AAA team. So I had my oldest son, Peter, in the car, and we're on our way to the rink, and being a typical bad parent, I grabbed him and I said, listen, you gotta make some noise here. You gotta be noticeable. I said, so don't be afraid to take the puck to the net. Shoot the puck when you get the opportunity. Go to the front of the net. They always notice people in tryouts that score goals or make plays. Okay, Dad, I got it. So this was a two-day tryout. It was Friday night, Saturday night, and then they were going to have people Friday night, Saturday morning, and they're going to have 90 down to 30 to come back on Sunday morning. So after the tryout on Friday night, he gets in the car, and his team had tied 3-3, and he had two goals, and he got in the car, and I looked at him, and I said, What are you doing? He's like, what? How did you think I played? I said, well, you didn't take the puck to the net hardly at all. I said, you didn't skate down the wing. You hardly shot the puck. You keep getting it and just throwing it to the middle of the ice. He's a left winger. And he said, all right, I'm sorry. He's 10 years old, 12 years old. And we get home. We drive back Saturday, and we're going to the rink. And I said, you know what you got to do? You got to make noise out here. You got to be noticeable. I said, there's 98 kids. There's one kid that's going to make it to the AAA team. And then there's only 30 kids that are going to make the AA team, so you got to make some noise here. All right, Dad, I got it. They end up winning the game, the scrimmage, 5-4. He had a goal and two assists in the scrimmage. And he gets in the car, and I look at him, and I said, what are you doing? He's like, what? I said, I told you to stop throwing the puck to the middle of the ice. Every time you get it on a breakout, you flip the puck to the middle of the ice. I said, get it. Take it wide. Drive over the defenseman. Put the puck at the net. You got to make a difference out there. He's like, okay, fine. We got a call that night. He was invited back Sunday morning. On the way to the rink again, being the good parent that I am, I grabbed him in the car and I said, do you understand what I'm saying to you? And he said, I got it, Dad. I got it. I said, well, then stop passing the puck to the middle of the ice. I said, grab it and go. Once you're going, maybe you make some plays from there. So we come back and there's only 30 kids left of the 98. And we're trying out for two teams plus the one spot on AAA. And when I'm the coach of the Carolina Hurricanes, and I go into a locker room, and it is packed. There's only two rooms, and the parents, it must have been like maybe 10 years old, the parents were all in there, and they were tightening the skates up for the kids. So we had to get in there, and you had to wedge yourself in to where you were going, and your kid was sitting between. Not a word was being said. There was so much tension in the room from the kids and most definitely from the parents. And we sit down, and nothing's being said, and I'm bent over and I'm doing my skate, and there was a nice lady right next to me, and her son was sitting in front of her. And she said to my son, she said, oh, She said, you're Peter, right? And he said, yeah. He said, my son, Jimmy, has been the sentiment on your line for the last two nights. And I'm down tightening my skates, and my son looks at her, and he said, my dad told me not to pass the puck to your son anymore. And I'm like this. I'm like this, head coach of the Hurricanes, okay? I'm like this. And I looked up at him, and I said, I did not say that. And I looked at her and I said, I did not say that. And he goes, yes, you did. You just told me in the car on the way in here. I'm like, I did not say that. I find it much easier to coach teams than my own kids. So when they asked me to come here and speak, I was honored. And they asked me what I'd like to speak on. And I decided right away, quickly, I said, I'd love to speak about offense. I had just come from my son's hockey night in Boston tournament. So it's not just when I look at a game, I look at NHL and how to create offense and how to be successful. I look at it at different levels, from even just watching my kids play in a tournament. And I realized that there's just things that I think that we do that I wanted to share, so I wanted to bring that topic and conversation here today. For me, offense is where I want to play. I think that coaches develop, they develop an identity. People will look around, you'll play against coaches that you play against all the time, and you'll say, okay, they're a defensive team that sits back, they're an attacking team, they're an undisciplined team, they're whatever it might be. They're a slow starting team. So I think that your teams take on traits of your coach, and ultimately your coach can dictate that. I want our team to always think about being on offense. I want to get into the offensive zone. I want to stay in the offensive zone. I want to have a pounding, relentless attack that never leaves the offensive zone. Now, I realize that in order to be successful, you have to play good defense. But I guess my mindset is, if you're playing offense, then you're not playing defense. I know that they say defense wins championships, and I don't necessarily disagree with that, because if you can't play defense, then you're going to have to score too many goals, and you can't do that, but maybe on the odd time. But defense, I think, is a priority, and your team does have to play it well. So while my message and my coach speak in my room constantly runs around possession of the puck and how do we get into the offensive zone, how do we stay there, and how do we score goals, our team was lowest last year in the National Hockey League at shots against at 27.3. So for me, I get the defensive part of it. I just don't want to play it. I want to play offense. And so every time I speak, I think that the players in the room, they listen and they want to learn, and they want to be taught, and they want to be coached, and they want to listen to what you have to say. So your message and your messaging, if you're constantly talking about defense and layers and pulling back and protecting and not turning the puck over, well, then that's the type of team that you'll have. If you want a team that's on the attack all the time, then you need to talk about an attack. You need to have a clear-cut identity for offense, and then work on that on a daily basis in practice and execute what you're trying to do. The question as you're sitting here, and I'm trying to explain myself, is ask yourself as a coach, what is your plan of attack? Do you have one? Do you have an identity? When you're going to go into your season this year, do you know in your mind what your identity is going to be? And will you be able to execute that in practice, in meetings and in practice, to get your team to play the way that you want them to play? I think that there's obvious offense. And everybody works on that. You might work on breakaways. You might definitely work on two-on-ones. I work on two-on-ones. You might work on three-on-twos. You might work on your power play. But I think what I wanted to emphasize more than anything today was, what do you do when there's no plan? And it happens 75% of the time, 80% of the time. There is no two-on-one. There is no breakaway. There is no power play. So how are you going to generate offense, and what identity are you going to have for your team? And so if I can get just that message out here today on some thoughts and some ideas, I feel like maybe I can have passed some of my information on to you that you can take back to your teams. In saying that, let me let me show you some things. When I put this together, I went mostly video. And I'm not sure if there's packets or not, but I only did maybe 12 PowerPoint presentations. For me, the best way to teach things to players is third, I guess, would be a PowerPoint presentation, because there's so many X's and O's that cross, and you know, whether you're 8 or whether you're 12 or whether you're 24, they have a hard time staying alert and paying attention to PowerPoint presentations, and they have to be short and concise and to the point. The next best way would be to show video. So given those two, and for me, the ultimate way is to go on the ice and actually practice what it is that you want to do and let the players run through it. We don't have any ice here and I don't have any players, so I chose mostly to go with what I think is the most effective way, which would be video. So I'm going to try and just put down some concepts here. First one, attacking, let me go here.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, coaches. How are you?
Good morning.
You know what? It's a good day, definitely. Just wanted to let you know what the offense is doing.
An awful skinny playbook, ain't it?
Well, I run 6 plays, split beers, like Novocaine. Just give it time, always works. See you on the bus.
I love that clip. I had to find it. It only came up, the cameras have come so far recently with high definition. That was not in high definition, as you could see. But I love the clip, and we found it, and I wanted to put it in here. I've done one neutral zone defense for 7 years in a row. Not two neutral zone. I did do two neutral zone defenses my second year in New York, and I got fired at the end of the year. And the reason I got fired is because the players went in there and they said to the coach, said, well, what do you think? And they said, well, we don't know what we're doing. And I threw in one extra neutral zone defense. We don't know what we're doing in the neutral zone. You don't have to have a lot of plays. You don't have to change. You don't have to go and watch the Canadians play and say, we're going to go do this new neutral zone defense or this new offensive zone system. What you need to do is find out what you like, who you are, what you're comfortable, and you need to sell that package to your team. So I thought that clip was awesome. They don't have a big playbook. They didn't have 50 plays that the kids need to learn and try to figure out what's what. They had 6 plays, know those 6 plays, do them very well, and you'll find success at the end of the day. So we keep it simple in Nashville. When it came to the offensive zone, we talked about attacking the offensive zone through the neutral zone. And as we thought about it, there was really only 3 ways to get through there. You can carry it in with possession. You can chip the puck with support and chip to possession, so you're chipping it to a driving player. Or you can dump it in and forecheck and recover. So with, again, these are just some philosophies and some ideas that come from me. I would love to see the puck with wide speed. So on breakouts or possession changes, sprint to offense. Your job off of transition in the defensive zone or the neutral zone is to go with speed and move quickly. Get transition up the ice. Look to beat the opposition up the ice. Challenge opposition's defense one-on-one with wide speed. So for me, if pucks can get to the middle of the ice, eventually I would like to see them with a defense in place. So not the breakaway goal, not the 3-on-1, but a defense in place. I would like to see an attack on the middle ice, and I would like to see the puck distributed to wide speed, because I think too many times when you take the puck and bring it to the middle of the ice, there's a defense in place and it leads to turnovers. And if you've got guys moving in north direction at a good pace, there's going to be turnovers and you're going to be vulnerable defensively coming back the other way. So if we can get a center attack middle ice with speed and distribute puck to wingers, center becomes middle lane drive. Some people do a wide drive. We do a middle lane drive. We split the defenseman. Weak side winger does a dot lane drive, but maybe a step behind. And the D add to the rush, fourth man. I could have put fifth man in there too, because all 5 guys are working to sprint to offense from the defensive zone or from neutral zone transition. And then the puck carrier must protect all the players that are driving hard at the net. You can't miss the net, have it rim out the weak side, and start the other team's offense with all of your players down by the goalie's crease. If you look at the diagram right here, there's 5 options to score a goal off here after you distribute it wide. So once you distribute it wide and you get to this point here, the 5 options for me would be a shot with a center lane drive, It would be a shot pass to the centerman with his stick on the ice for a redirect. It would be the centerman driving these two defensemen back and a pass to the weak side wing. It would be the winger driving wide and a pass to the weak side defenseman, or the winger driving wide and it being clogged up in here and dropping it back to a D-man here. If there's nothing here, you could put it back behind the net. You could take it down and spin up and see what might be available. But what you don't want your wingers to do is to drive in here and start putting pucks blind, because, again, the only thing you're doing at that point is starting the other team's transition. So if your team's going to make a play, have them see the play. And if they see a play and they turn it over, that's one thing. If they're doing things blind and throwing pucks away, we try to get away from that as much as possible. Coming out from behind the net and just throwing it to the front of the net. A lot of times it's going into the defense's hand and they're sprinting the other way. So I put through some clips here, and we've got a new computer on Exos here, and they did a just getting back in the office here and working with it. It did a really good job of highlighting the piece that you wanted to work with. So I'm working through it here too with you guys. I might back up a couple times, but you get a real chance to see what's going on with the offense. So we get the puck wide here, and you can see that now we've got it almost where we wanted it in that diagram. And for me, this doesn't have to be a centerman. This could be a defenseman. It could be it's whatever we come out of the zone and how we get five guys. And all five guys have to know where the other four are supposed to be. If you're a left winger, you need to know where the right winger needs to be in case you're on that side, because it's not always set in stone that the center's in the center lane, the left winger's in the left lane. This is Craig Smith. He's our right winger. He gets the puck in the center of the ice, but yet everything remains the same. He gets the puck wide here, and he distributes it, and then he takes off to the net, and you can see once he comes in, he gets that quick hit. So that was the one, and then he stops in front of the net as well, where he gets that opportunity in front of the net. This is the same one. You can see that there's a center lane drive. It gets to that point right there. The same thing that I showed you on that. And the reason why I didn't do too many of the PowerPoint clips is because there's so many things that can happen. But off the video, you can see it. There's the center lane drive, the weak side of the ice, and the weak side defenseman. He opts to shoot the puck because everything seems locked up through the middle of the ice. Again, same thing. There is no winger. Our winger came off the wall, so our centerman drives wide. But again, everybody gets into the same position. A center lane drive, a weak side of the ice, and then Craig Smith gets a stick on it for a redirect in front of the net. This is Roman Josi, our defenseman. So again, he's filled the center position. So whoever's not part of the three here, it ends up being... It ends up being Mike Ribeiro. He pulls back into the defenseman's position, but Roman kicks the puck out to the winger. He drives through, and that actually went off Roman and into the net. Same thing here. We get a center lane drive, and it opens up the weak side of the ice. Watch the strides on Colton Sissons here. So if you're going to have a center lane drive, when you're going to work on this, you say you're going to work on a 3-on-2 in practice, and you want to push the puck to the centerman, coach pushes it to the centerman, that centerman has to get going. You can't stand still and watch your winger take off and make a pass to your winger. He's got to get going with equal speed or more speed, and you can just see his strides at the center ice position once he distributes his puck. All five guys working to get up the ice. You can see Shea Weber working to get up. And the fact that Colton got through and he pushed everybody through, that opened up the seam to the weak side of the ice. Just a different clip here, kind of the same thing. We get the center lane drive. We hit the weak side defenseman again, and this time we offer a pass off the redirect. So this would be instead of hitting the weak side defenseman, I tried to pull one clip of everything that I talked about going through it with the five options that were there off the rush with possession. This would be our winger driving in deep, pushing the defense back, and then hitting the strong side defenseman. Whenever you run your practices, we constantly harp on, I know most coaches do, just making sure that you stop in front of the net, making sure that you stand in front of the goalie. And even my kids, my players on my team, my boys, I just went and watched them play in a tournament. You know, the goalie's here, and they want to They think it's better to stand off to the side and wait for the one time. This guy in front of the net is the guy that has to take the goalie's vision. And while he may or may not get the goal, it certainly will create confusion and probably a rebound and a second chance. This is really good position. We get a low guy in front of the net taking the goalie's eyes, and then we get a push from the weak side guy as well. And this is the same thing. Mike Ribeiro drives in, he drops it to a strong side D. But you can see all of the clips look the same. And if there's a reason why, and I guess that goes back to what I said, like, we work on an identity every day. We don't do drills just for the sake of doing drills. We do drills that we want to see executed in practice on a daily basis. We run 3-on-2s maybe every day or every other day, or 5-on-2s. And we tell our defensemen to stay between the dots, because defensemen will go outside the dots and screw up the drill force. So we make the D stay between the dots, and that will allow the pass wide. And then you can distribute the puck from, you can call out the options if you want to, or you can let them pick the options. I would call them out if you're just introducing it to your team. Hit the guy going, take a shot off the wing, hit the guy going to the net, hit the weak side forward, hit the late defenseman. So this is a good play. We had nothing going on. The forward decides to pull up. There's nothing wrong with just putting the puck. I call this living to fight another day. Just put the puck down behind the net. See what's going to happen. See what's going to come up. We ended up cycling the puck and coming out of it. We come around the top, and again, traffic with people going to the front of the net. Same thing here. There's nothing here. We spin out of it. We don't have anything, and we put it back behind the net. It's a safe play. There's nothing wrong with that. It's better to play behind the goal line and look for possession or look to create a different scoring opportunity than to back check 200 feet and give up a 3-on-2. So that was that. Those were all possession. Okay. So now, when you can't get in the zone with possession and you're forced to chip, more than anything, the guy coming through the neutral zone with the puck, you need him to make a good decision. Putting the puck to the middle of the ice for a turnover, turning it over himself, they've got to be committed to making sure that they make the right decision, again, to eliminate turnovers. So if you get the puck wide with speed and you do get stood up, you've got to put it behind him. If you can chip to support or chip to your player driving through, that would be a great option for me where you can maintain possession. What I was talking about obvious offense, once you chip the puck through and your centerman drives through and gets it, my question to you as a coach would be, okay, you've executed that. What's your team doing from there? What's the plan? Because a lot of times as coaches, we sit there, the guy gets in the corner, he's got a defenseman right on him, and he turns it over, and you're yelling from the bench, move it, move it. Well, to who? To where? When? How? So those are the questions that you have to ask as a coach. If we were to chip this puck in, every time possible for me, I want it to go behind the net. And our forecheck structure, and that's coming up next, is a 2-3. So as this plays out, you're always going to see two guys up in the zone. I used to call it a 2-1-2. The one would be F3. I'd lose F1 and F2 on the forecheck, and the third forward would be F3. And I used to call it a 2-1-2, and that one, you know, sometimes he gets up there too far and he goes below the dot and he gets down towards where the puck is, and the minute it turns over, we're chasing something back. So from a visual standpoint, I wanted them to think about it as a 2-3. Two guys on the attack looking to turn over pucks, three guys in a good defensive position. Once that happens, I want to change sides and I want to come away from where the puck was, not have F2 spin back behind the net and take it back to where all the defenders are. And we'll get to that in a second here. Make the right read, smart decision, don't force a play to the middle. Chip to middle lane drive, driving through, and look to maintain possession. A hard rim is an option. If there's no center lane drive, you can rim to possession. So a lot of times we would rim from the left winger to the right winger, and he would get pressure. My goal at that point would be to bump it right back around, coming out the other side, back to the left winger. Because wherever the puck goes in the defensive zone into a corner, five defenders are going to go. So I don't want to play on that side of the ice. I want to play back over on this side of the ice. So even if it's a rim around, I want to rim it back around the other way. And I've got some good clips of it for you coming up here. So this is a good decision. Our left winger, I think it's Colin Wilson, gets in trouble here. I don't want him to turn this puck over. He's not feeling comfortable about a play to the middle, and that's fine with me. So what he does is he lays it to an area, and as it comes in here, again, this kind of looks like my forecheck too, with two guys getting up the ice. But we could get here first, and it might be hard to see, but we push that. For me, it doesn't matter how it gets to the other side of the ice. You can kick it, you can poke it, you can use your elbow, get it to the other side of the ice, because that's the side that I want to play on. And as it comes out, as Craig Smith gets this puck, don't take it back into, what I was saying was, don't take it back into here. Get this puck and come over into here and see what's up. So that was a play where we ended up turning over possession. We ended up maintaining possession off of a chip. Here's another one. You can see that our centerman is drive through. Even though he's on the weak side of the ice, if he takes hard strides from here and comes pounding through here, he can be the first guy on this puck. We are not comfortable making a play to the middle of the ice at this point. So he puts it in behind. Objective, get it to the other side of the ice as soon as possible. As it comes out the other side, get away from this guy and bring it this guy. One, this guy was on this side of the ice. One, two, three, four guys over here. I want to play over on this side of the ice. I want to use the points. So as I move on in this presentation, I want to go side to side as quick as possible. I want to go low to high as quick as possible. I don't want my players hanging on to the puck that much unless they feel like they need to, and they're using cutbacks and scissors and trying to create low cycle plays. Use the points right away. I was at my son's tournament, and again, my sons are 17 and 18, so maybe your players are a little older, maybe they're a little bit younger. I was amazed at the lack of times that they did not use the points. But unless you're practicing that, using the points, unless you put five guys, 5-on-0 in the offensive zone, put a puck to the half wall, use the back of the net, and as that player comes out the other side, unless you're pounding that into your team's identity, point, 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 it's not going to happen. You can sit there and yell from the bench, but unless you've worked on it in three practices in a row, five practices in a row, we work on it all year long. Unless you work on it to use the points, they're probably not going to use the points. And the thing about it, too, is if you were to use the net and come out this other side here and get to here, you could throw this puck blind because the guy that's covering this defenseman, he's sitting down in here somewhere protecting the front of that. You could throw it blind 100% of the time. Get it, bank it off to the boards, get it out here, and you've got yourself a shot and an opportunity at the net. That's coming just a little bit later. Again, great traffic in front of the net and getting in there, getting your nose down on the puck and looking for some rebounds. This is a self-chip, which for me is the same thing. Again, I want two guys up the ice hard, and you can see at this point here that our third forward ends up staying high, but we're in that forechecking position again. We change sides, we bring it out, and then immediately, again, this is the forward here that has an opportunity to cover our defenseman, but everything takes it back in. Get it out right away. Good decision there to self-chip. So as it gets into this area in here, your second forward up the ice is going to have to realize whether or not it's a chip or whether or not it gets scrummed up in this area. We still have possession, but it didn't get moved, so he changes his route. Instead of coming this way, he gets in here. Anytime that there's battles in the offensive corners, I always say I want numbers on the puck. I never want to be looking at 2-on-1 their color, 3-on-1 their color. So I would want my guy to get on the inside of their players and make it a 2-on-1 in our favor. So right now we've just gone and outnumbered these guys and made it a quick 2-on-1. Again, so just to pound the identity, Colin Wilson picks this puck up and he pauses for a second. He gets it and he's thinking about, you can tell that he's thinking about coming this way, but look, count them up again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Why do we want to come back out this way? And you'll have to work a year on this. You'll have to work every practice on getting your team to come out this side of the ice. But if you do, and this guy were to come across, and he goes back to the net, you're going to get a scoring chance. So it comes back out. We end up using the D. D to D. Good tip, good redirecting tip in front. So those were just some examples of a chip and support. Again, attacking through the neutral zone. If you don't have anything, for me, the last option would be to give up possession. If I can't carry it in and I can't chip it to support to somebody, then I would forecheck somebody. And so again, we use the terminology of a 2-3. F1 pursues the puck with speed. Be physical on the puck. Time and space as quick as possible. Some people look for angles, like to angle him. I just want to get on him. I want to take the most direct route, and I want to make him feel uncomfortable and turn the puck over. While he's doing that, the second forward has to be taking the same strides as the first forward, and he has to be tracking the defenseman, the opposite defenseman. So you can see here that F2 for us is tracking this guy here. If they had sent their defenseman, if he went back into this corner where they had D and D and they were looking for some sort of a reverse, I would take F2 and send him right into this corner full speed and make it a 2-on-2. F3 for me lines up with the puck above their rush, above the top of the circles in a safe defensive posture. But if the puck's here, I want my F3 right here. If the puck's here, I want my F3 here. And as it changes sides, possibly, I want my F3 to come over and be in line with the puck. If they were to chip it up the strong side, for me on the forecheck, F3 goes, strong side D never pinches. And anytime the puck gets rimmed to the weak side, or if it gets pushed to here, and because we got so much pressure, he just continues to push. I call it a D-to-D, keep it moving. We want the weak side defenseman pinching and F3 backing up. So no pinch here, and then a pinch here. These are just a couple of clips of the forecheck. So you can see it comes down in here, but right away you can see exactly in the diagram of what it said. We're tracking two defensemen with speed. It's physical. He keeps it moving. This defenseman doesn't have time to make a play, so my weak side defenseman should be creeping in already. He knows this puck's going on the yellow, and he's down the wall, and you can see F3 backing him up. So that was just an example of the 2-3-4 check where we keep the puck in. I like the fact that we took a shot on a shot mentality in this clip right here, and that our defenseman, again, was kind of pre-pinching the wall, and Mike Fisher, who was F3 to begin with, remains as F3 and looks to back up our defenseman. We have a saying in the offensive zone with regard to F3 because we lose them, and usually when we don't play well in a game or we've given up too much, it's because we lost F3. So we talk about it a lot. The saying is, when they have possession, F3 has to be high. When possession is in question, F3 has to be high. When we have possession, it's all five guys looking for offense. I don't care where they go, because it's too hard to score goals inside a D-zone cover structure. So all five guys have the ability to move and go anywhere they want. But when we don't have possession or they have possession, F3 has to be there. Again, you can kind of see it through the picture here. We've got two guys coming. There's F1 coming in. F2 comes in. I like the separation. Excuse me. F3 was on this side of the ice because it started here. It got moved to here by their defenseman. So our F3 put himself right over in here. Again, mirroring the puck in this area. We get separation. We hang on to our position. And just from the forecheck there, we get two quick chances at the net. Again, a self-chip to a forecheck. This one here gets tied up. We end up dumping it through. And as you see, it comes in. There's no need to track the defenseman anymore. We want numbers into the battle. There's been a pause. We get the second guy in there. We get position in the battle and work to come up with the puck. Again, low to high right away and back to the front of the net with a high-low screen. And then I like the jump from F3 to turn that puck and sustain offense. So from just a forecheck there again, two or three quick chances with a good screen. With regard to offensive zone play, there's got to be an identity here as well. This is mostly I'm talking about D-zone coverage. When all five defenders are in there, how are you going to generate offense? Because it's hard at any level to get through five guys. So for me, F1, recover the puck and look to change sides. Whenever you can, again, if the puck is in, where it is in this drill here, all five guys would be somewhere in here. I want to get it over here as quick as possible, have F3 move, D move, D move. F2, be ready to support the puck and come out the other side and puck retrieval. F3, move from side to side, both D shift. This is a key here, quick low to high puck movement, pass to either F3 or pass out to the defenseman. Low cycles where maybe this forward gets it, cuts back, F1 comes over and supports him, F3, so good cycles with F1 and F2. A typical cycle is to get the puck in this area here, start to skate up, bump it back to this guy who might be coming over. F2 cruises around like this. F1 gets it, comes up, bumps it back. Our cycle goes, if F2 gets this puck and he cycles it, we want F2 immediately to turn and come back and create a scissor and leave the wall open for a possible drop pass. And that will allow confusion on the defense and maybe a quick hit to F3 or a defenseman. High cycles with the D, a D down the wall, a D dive cycle with the weak side D. So I've got clips of everything here that I'm talking about through the video, so I just wanted to show you guys. The last part of it is the grind and cycle option. So this is when there's literally nothing, pucks are in the corner. How are you going to generate offense, and what identity is your team going to have? And again, I've got good clips of this. So I'd rather move through this and just get to the video. The last thing I put down on here is to shoot the puck at every option. If there's an opportunity with traffic at the net, that puck's got to be delivered to the net. And sometimes we wait, sometimes we look for a better option. Usually a shot with traffic means a rebound. It means possession back in your hands. It means a second opportunity or a third opportunity and continued offense at the goal. Look for screens, tips, rebounds, because of those will enhance your opportunities for success in the offensive zone. So these are just a couple clips here. So this is all offensive zone play. We're now in the zone. We've entered. We've down in there. What's your plan? What's your identity? What are you working on in practice? So right away, Paul Gostad has nothing. He's looking at the fans. We've established a net front position here. But there's not really a play to be made. 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm not sure where the fifth one is. I bet he's out here somewhere. I want to get it over to here as quick as possible. He knows this because every day we do a drill. I'm going to give you the one drill. It's my go-to drill. I do it every day. I definitely don't go two practices without doing the drill I'm going to show you. Because it puts in their mind to use the back of the net whenever they're in trouble. So he uses the back of the net here. We know to come out, and without even thinking about it, I circled Patrick Kane here. He's in good defensive position, but there's not a chance that he can keep this puck from going to the point. So we get it out right away. We move it. We use D to D. Sorry. We use D to D movement, and again, we get a really good high-low screen in front. We take the goaltender's eyes. We get a push at the net. Excuse me. Again, Mike Ribeiro has nothing. He's getting closed off. He's not comfortable using the D. As this guy starts to climb, your options to pass to the defenseman become limited. If we're going to use the defenseman, it's better to use him down in here while this guy's down lower. Get this puck, move it up. If you can't and you're cycling the puck, Craig Smith's already kind of knowing where it's going. I don't mind him standing here because if he were to be a righty and come out of here and shoot this puck, we get a net front presence. But he doesn't have any opportunity. Craig Smith knows where he's going. He pauses for a second again because it would be easy. It's natural instinct for him to turn back into it and to keep going, but to turn into it and get it and then change your momentum and come back out the other side. But you can see he pauses. Now he comes. He gets help from Phillip. And again, a shot at the net, traffic, and people going back to the front of the net. Again, I just like this. It was off of a soft chip, side to side, point shot, one chance. It's numbers at the net. It's a second chance. So, again, there's not a lot that can go on here. I don't know if we have a defenseman change. I saw him look, so maybe he's not comfortable sending it back to the point, but he is getting closed off. He will get played unless he keeps the puck moving, uses the back of the net immediately. F3, who was here supporting, now shifts over to this side of the ice. Just a good quick hit coming out the weak side. Good move by Colin Wilson here, protecting the puck, keeping his feet moving, getting out the weak side. Again, you can see everybody on this side. This is F3. He's eventually going to work his way over. And again, it puts this guy in a jam, especially if this is a guy like Shea Weber standing out at the point. Like, which one do you want to take away? Where's your worst poison here? So at this point here, he's not guarding the middle, so we get our head up. And again, just a quick hit, gets to the front of the net, and good traffic in front. There's nothing wrong with, in practice, just doing one-on-ones where you're just putting pressure on a guy's back and having him cut, take space, maintain possession until something presents itself offensively. Ryan Johansson, he's using his body. Anytime we do drop passes or we protect the puck, anytime I drop the puck in the offensive zone, I always want to drop it to the outside. because everybody's on the inside. If Ryan Johansson's going to cut back, like, I don't want him cutting this way. I want him cutting using the wall, taking the space, keeping the puck safe, trying to protect it as much as possible. Takes it to the other corner. There's nothing over here. This guy may be getting a bead. So he continues on here and cuts it back again, side to side, out to F3 for a quick hit. You can see here that we're losing possession. There's not a lot that we can do here. We know where the puck's going. It ends up coming back behind and right away without even looking. I mean, it was quick. There is no thinking about what to do with it. We get it. We get back to the front of the net. And again, the traffic, you have to harp all the time. Guys don't necessarily want to go and get cross-checked and get into this blue area here, but this is the area that makes a difference. So continually work on it in practice. But you can see both guys. I love the fact that he didn't stand here. He worked to get back and take the goalie's eyes. He can't see the puck. We get a push from the secondary guy on the outside, and it ends up hitting a stick. Again, just changing sides out the weak side, and a quick hit. There's nowhere to go here. This guy was down on the wall. But we get our head up, so we don't change sides this time. We just get it out quick, low to high. Watch what Shea does here. Like, you should, if you get an opportunity to work with your defenseman, it's easy just to shoot the puck, but have them work on stopping and changing the direction to get around the shin guards. Shea does an excellent job here of getting back away from this guy, finding a lane. We get net front, and we get a high tip, so we get a high-low screen and a redirect on it. This is just a different look at it. Again, watch Shea, just a quick movement, just gets him going one way and then pulls it back. And there's no way the goalie can see the puck. Again, this is Colin Wilson. He could hang on to this puck if he wants to, I think. He's big enough and strong enough. He's got position, but he doesn't think twice about it. It's low to high, net front presence, and because he moved the puck and went back to the net, he ends up getting the goal. If there isn't anything, if you do use your defenseman and there's nothing there, it goes back behind the net, and if you drill it in with your team enough, we'll know that this puck, he doesn't have anything. If it's going this way, it's getting to this back post back in here by the Nationwide. We'll try to pick it up and come back the other way. And again, just F3 moving from side to side, getting over there, putting yourself in a position, getting it to him, back to the front of the net. It's a good look there. Again, there's nothing going on. So we were already knowing that it was going behind the net. Right here, you can see Mike, he cheats in behind, out the other side, and then a quick hit to F3. I like the cutback. That's a defenseman up in the play. I'm perfectly fine with that. My defensemen don't have to get in and get out. They can get in and stay in there if they're going to. Well, I got Roman Josi too, so if you guys get a Roman Josi, let him stay in there and play. But I like the, sorry, I had highlighted that one. As he comes up here, what I like in this play here is that there's absolutely nothing for us to do. And again, I just call it living to fight another day. Keep possession, stay in the offensive zone, but don't just throw the puck away. Don't give it to the opposition. So we get this puck in this area here. There's nothing. We know it's going behind the net. We come out. So we went from a situation on the wall where we had absolutely nothing and a game plan to get it to here. Fisher's able to come out the other side and put that puck at the net for a good scoring opportunity. Again, nothing from our defensemen. Gostad goes behind. He tries the wrap, doesn't get it, but it goes to Salamaki, and he gets two chances off of it. This is going to happen a lot. If you've got a shot mentality team, it's going to happen a lot where the puck's going to, you're going to look in this situation right in here, right? You've been using your players to try and generate offense. You have to pound home the message again about the numbers. Don't let them be 3-on-1 on you. Don't let them have that advantage. Take your second man and put him on the inside. Have him work to get there. Send him into the battle as quick as he can and take a 3-on-1 and turn it into a 2-on-1 in your favor. I just like the strides. I like the strides by... Did I lose it? I like the strides by our high forward here. He just gets in there right away. He sees it. It's a 3-on-1. His strides are hard, and he makes it a 2-on-1 in our favor, and he goes in and turns over a puck, and we maintain possession. We try to change sides there. It ends up getting stopped up, but we keep it in. And I don't mind this either. We end up getting into a battle here. We send that second guy in. Again, I always like to cycle. I like to leave a wall open. So he comes over, he offers a pick. I'd rather see him do that than him come in head first on him and leave it with nowhere to go. He provides a little bit of a pick right there, and that's enough time to get it to the front of the net. And again, I just like the fact that we got three guys down in there inside the blue paint, and we're wrestling to try and find a rebound. So there's some good things that happen here. We get this puck here. Our F3 gets in motion. Like I said, once you're in motion, I think that we're into some of the D cycles here. Once you get your team in motion, and we're moving now, F3 has the green light to generate offense. Get going. Make something happen. Find it. So he decides to go down the wall. We don't give it to him at that point, okay? So if we're going to, we allow our forwards to pass the puck to the D whenever there's an area, but we have a mark on the ice at the hash marks that says, okay, there was no pass. And as he starts to climb, this guy's starting to climb as well. So the pass to the D for me is not a good option. So we still need to generate offense at this point. When he hits the hash mark, it's a green light for this guy to go. So I'll show you some D down the wall cycles. So he gets this puck. It's an opportunity where we recognize it. He needs help. Our D goes. And that almost sneaks in there. It's a good shot with net front traffic. Out the weak side of the ice, hash mark, D down the wall. We do drop it there. We drop it to the outside because it's a safer place. Come around the other side and get a quick scoring chance. That almost went in. I just like Colin Wilson here. Again, this is back to the entries. This was off of an entry. So he puts himself in a position. There's nothing there. Shoot the puck. Get it off a far pad. We get a center lane drive and a push from the weak side of the net. Nothing happens. I love the way this looks right here. We got a guy in the slot ready to shoot it. We've got a guy with his head up and the puck on his stick. We got a defenseman realizing that there's not a lot that's going to happen here. And he gets going down the wall and he makes a nice play. That one was really good. I'm going to show it to you guys again. Again, sorry, the cycle up the wall. Our D going down, he picks it up, comes around the back side, and another quick scoring opportunity. So when it's not there and the pass, we're not passing it low to high anymore. If you can get your defensemen involved and get them active and put a plan in place and work on it in practice so that it becomes natural and because they don't guess where the defenseman's supposed to go or when he's supposed to go. And you have to set those guidelines too, because the last thing you want is a forward that's thinking about passing the puck to the defenseman and a defenseman's just cycling down the wall because he feels like it. And if you can set up some guidelines on when to go, how to go, where to go, you won't end up just passing the puck out of your zone because you went to pass it low to high and your defenseman was thinking about cycling down the wall. This clip's got a lot of good things in it. We change sides. We come around. There's nothing there, so we try to get it back behind. It doesn't get there. But we end up putting this puck still to this area here. We take our F3. We have possession. It's not in question. We have it, so we need to use all of our guys to generate. We don't need F3. He puts it behind the net. Again, comes out the other side. He uses a D down the wall. We get a quick hit in front. Recovery. F1 and F2, once these pucks go here, the strides to recover pucks are so important to staying in the offensive zone. There's a D down the wall here. We decide not to use it. We go for the F3. And again, traffic. And then that's a defenseman who's up in the rush. Again, five guys looking to score a goal. We're on the attack at this point. And it ends up being our defenseman who puts it in. Good decision by our D-man here. There's nothing going on, so he ends up putting it down behind the net. He can't get it through. You can see the D down the wall here. And just this D down the wall, anytime you get your D in motion here, you don't look at our guys for a second. Look at what it does to the defense. Anytime you can get scissors going where this guy's coming, you're not sure who handles it anymore. Same thing here. We get a D going down the wall. This is a, D dive down the wall with the opportunity to cycle with the weak side D. Again, they're going to start dropping off because they're not sure. So he stops. There's gaps now. There's room to make plays. We got a defenseman that came over. So we sent the D down, brought this D over, brought him up. And again, traffic with an opportunity at the net. So the wall's taken care of here. So those with D down the walls, a D dive would be if we dove to the middle of the ice. This is an opportunity where we send the guy down the middle through the guts and not down the wall, and we pop it to him, look for a quick hit. Again, same thing, just using the entire ice, coming up the wall. We use a D dive, so you can see him going through. You can see Shea coming over. And again, there's just confusion. Is he dropping it? Is he not dropping it? And what it does is it just allows a little bit of a gap in space for him to get a shot off. It's a little thing, but I like that Nealer, who is the high forward, he turns and he goes back and creates a scissor right here. So we have a D dive going on. We've got a scissor going on. And again, all it does is just freezes things for a second. We have a defenseman coming over, so they're not sure if they're going to drop the puck, and it just creates a lot of confusion. Anytime you can practice drills where you can get a player to turn and come back to the puck carrier and create that scissor, you put a pause in the defense. You've made them stop just for a second and say, okay, who do I have? And it may allow just enough opportunity to get a shot off. Again, same thing. We sent the defenseman through. This defenseman came around the back door. We end up dropping it in a safe area and then taking it to the net. Ends up drawing a penalty on that one. I like the fact, again, instead of forcing something, we get this puck, instead of forcing something in here, we've got guys that are moving. Our defensemen might be moving. I would rather not turn the puck over at this point. So there comes a discipline in your system, too, to do the right thing, make the right decision. The right decision is just to put it back in the corner at this point. We come out of it, we get a D dive, we get a D exchange up top, a cycle, and again, just the traffic at the front of the net. So just a couple things. With offensive zone play and your identity, when you're in trouble, use the back of the net and try to work on as much as you can. The quicker you do things, the better. I don't know if you're yelling at your team all the time to do things faster. Work on that in practice. Don't do things at half speed. And this is going to be awkward. When you start to do these things, even me in training camp this year, they're going to come back. It's going to be awkward. They're going to be bumping into each other. They're going to go down the middle. They should have went down the wall. They'll be going away from each other instead of coming back and creating that scissor. The more you do it, the quicker you'll get at it. The quicker you get at it, the more offense that you'll generate. Have a shot mentality. If you can come out of off the goal line and put a puck at the net, and you got traffic there, put it at the net, because good things will happen. Use your points. Get the puck to the net. With that, you need traffic screens and tips. Those will lead to second chances. And then once you're creating all this offense and you're putting pucks at the net, you got to have that dog on a bone mentality to recover pucks, to keep possession and stay in the offensive zone. Just 10 key points I put down for you guys. Transition with speed to offense. It's a race. Make the right decision on the entry. Carry it in. Chip to support. Dump it in. But make the right decision. Eliminate turnovers. Stick to the terminology or coach speak. Come up whatever coach speak you use and stick with that. Let your players know what F3 means. Let them know what cycle down the wall or D-dive means. Let them know what an I-formation tip is. Whatever the terminology you want to use, come up with it, use it, and have them understand it as well, and then execute on entries in your offensive zone plan. Have a plan on wide entries, chip and support, and forecheck. We talked about that. Everybody can dump a puck. What's the plan? You got to have a plan in place in order to get it back. When you're jammed up or in trouble, look to use the back of the net and come out the other side. And you're going to find that when you use the back of the net, that player who gets it behind the net, he's going to want to bring it right back into those five players. Have them come out the other side if you can. Inside your plan, hang on to the puck. Use cycles, use cutbacks, use scissors, use picks. All of that will help open things up to generate offense. Speed, speed, speed. Don't be playable. Move your feet, move to support, move the puck. Something's got to be moving. The minute you stop moving, you're played. Once you're played, you're going back to play defense. So keep something moving. You need a shot mentality. It creates second chances. My assistant coach, Kevin McCarthy, he constantly gets in front of the players and just makes stuff up. So every once in a while, he'll chime in. It's gone up since I've known him. And he'll chime in at the end of my meeting. He says, guys, do you know that every time you shoot the puck, 83% of the time you get it back? Now, that's not a statistic. But he says it all the time. And when I was with him in Carolina, it was like 62% of the time you get it back. So either the number's really going up or he's just increasing it to make a point. Be quick to recover pucks when you lose possession, and that dog on a bone mentality, there's something to that. Go YouTube a dog on a bone. Try to take a bone away from a dog. When your team starts to play like that, you'll win a lot of hockey games. You must practice your identity, and that's your responsibility as a coach. Don't just say, move it, move. Where are they moving it? And if they do have a plan and they don't do it, then you can go back and say, hey, you know you're supposed to bump it behind the net. Hey, you know you're supposed to use the defenseman. So put that plan in place, and then you got to work at it all the time. If you do, I promise you, you'll change your team offensively to become a much stronger team. I put these last clips in just because they were big goals. So we work on our identity the entire year, from training camp until here. These are four clips. This is at home in the second round against Nashville. You can see that we're down. There's 4 minutes to go in the game. We end up turning just a shot mentality. So, I don't know, maybe Mike Fisher's not going to score from there. He puts it at the net. That's one. That's two. Yeah, like Nealer's reaction here. Do you see this? Watch him shoot the puck. Oh. Anyway, he gets it. Colin Wilson, this is what I'm talking about. What's the plan? The recovery's in place. What's the plan? He goes low to high. Net front presence. We do an excellent job of taking the goaltender's eyes. Comes back out to a high forward who's pushing at the net in a second wave. And we ended up tying up the game. That's a possessed man right there. Wide speed on entry. Don't turn the puck over here. We're down a couple goals here in the third. We end up battling back here. But, again, we have nothing, so we use it. Remember I mentioned you can soft chip to the center, or you can maintain possession by rimming it to the weak side winger. This one's a rim to the weak side winger. We don't want the puck over on this side anymore. Get it back. So we rim it. He gets it right away. We know it's going back to the other side of the net. It comes out, low to high, quick point shot, traffic in front of the net, and a quick rebound. Make sure your guys are standing right in front of the goaltender's eyes. If you want to work on a drill in practice for your tip-ins, have your players just stand right in front of the goalie and work on tipping pucks like this, not standing off to the side and tipping a puck like this, because if you can snap pucks, not slap shots, just have your defensemen wrist them in, and the goalie's there. If you can have your player standing there like this, the net front presence guy, and work on just getting a piece of a redirect this way, here, here, over here on his backhand, down low. And that way you've done two things. You're working on redirects, and you've taken the goalie's vision. And it might be James Neal scored that first clip that I showed you. That wasn't him. That was the guy in front of the net who took his vision. But because he couldn't see it, the rebound came out to a second wave, and he was able to get it. Again, just quick puck movement, wide speed. We push it through. We keep the puck safe here. There's nothing. Our D jumps a little bit early here, but that's okay. He's got speed in the game. Again, a safe drop to the outside. Come back around the other side. And a big goal. And then this last one here. This is game 7 in the first round. We ended up winning this game, I think, 2-1, so this was the game-winning goal. We get the puck with wide speed. There's nothing here. Again, use of the net right away. Get it over to the other side. You can see all the guys are on this side of the ice right now. Get it over here. Get it away. It goes up high. Quick hit. And we get a rebound in front of the net. And that ended up being the game winner. So good things from that. I told you guys I was going to give you one drill here. It's again, there's so much movement off of it that I want to try to walk through it. And if you got a question on it, you can. We do this drill. Like I told you, we do it every day. If we don't do it every day, we never go two practices without doing it. This will get your team to use the back of the net, to cycle the puck, to battle, to support, and to shoot the puck and have a shot mentality. So it's called 3-on-1, 3-on-2, 3-on-3. And basically, I only use two colors in practice just because I feel like it's easier to move people around. But if you have a coach here with pucks, there's going to be three parts to it. There'll be one defenseman in front of the net. On the whistle, your coach spots a puck in here. They have to use the back of the net. So there's a pass to the back of the net. At that point, both of these players come out from behind the goal line. This guy can move. You're in a little bit of a triangle here. You get to take one pass. It can come out and stuff. It can come out, and you can hit the back door and come out. You can hit the high forward who moves over into here, and you get one quick shot and one quick rebound, a 3-on-1, okay? When that's over, we add a defenseman in, and the coach will spot a puck to the half wall, and we take the defenseman and we bring him in, so we now have two defenders in here. We don't allow the defender to touch the puck until the back of the net is used and possession is maintained, okay? So your D-man can't cheat and cut off the cycle. They can't go get the puck if this guy's not here in time. This guy has to get the puck. When he has it, have him face the glass, and if you can, try to keep the puck on the yellow, because the minute you start caroming pucks off the yellow, you never know where they're going to go. So if they can get to the yellow, rim it to the back far post, and get it into this area, have this player right here and come out the weak side, and then this forward comes over, he can cycle to the outside, he can bring it up, and that creates a scissor right away. This defenseman most likely will come, get this guy going, get this guy to the outside, and you can have a drop or not have a drop at that point, but then just play it 3-on-2. And as you get good at it, when this happens, and this continues on, because this one will go for 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 30 seconds, there might be a shot and a rebound, and this forward might go get it. If he didn't use the back of the net and it gets killed, tell him that he should have used the back of the net. So off of this second play, get it, send it back behind the net, and that will cue in one of these players that they've got to read that as the drill continues, somebody's got to get to the back of the net and come out the other side, and then let it play. This drill ends when a goal is scored, a save is made, or the two defensemen clear the puck past here, okay? The third part of it is, as soon as that's over and one of those three things happen, take a puck, spot it to the other side, forward comes over, has to use the back of the net, has to come out the other side, get his feet moving, this high forward and come around. Again, you can cycle it if you want, and play the 3-on-3 live. You add another forward in, so you end up with two defensemen and a forward down in this area in here, and you're playing 3-on-3. Once the puck is scored, tied up, or cleared, you change them up. You would put in three blue jerseys, one red jersey, and repeat. And if you do that enough, you're going to find that you're using the back of the net. Once you do that, if you wanted another drill, you could just take five guys and do this same setup right here. Get all these guys out of here, have them out here. You go both ends if you got two coaches. Just go 5-on-0, okay? It's really simple, but I think sometimes we complicate and confuse things as coaches. You know, if we want to work on a 3-on-2, we say, all right, let's break out, let's go through the neutral zone, let's regroup, let's counter, and let's come back and enter on possession. I'm like, let's just go through the neutral zone. There's so many things that can go wrong on the breakout or the counter, or people are now out of position. Just work on what you want to work on. Don't be afraid to take five guys, okay, move this out of here. So there's just two defensemen, a red D, and no defenders in here at all. Spot a puck here. Have him use the back of the net, have this guy get out here, and the first one, you could have him come out here and hit F3, quick shot. Have a coach spot a puck, use the back of the net, come out the other side. Use the D, drag, change angles, snapshot. Spot a puck, use the back of the net, come out the other side. Out to the D, D to D, shot on net. Spot a puck, use the back of the net, come out the other side. Have him skate this time, have him get up to the hash marks, have this D come down the wall, have a drop pass. So just four parts to it. Come out the weak side, hit F3. Come out the weak side, hit the strong side defenseman for a shot. Come out the weak side, go D to D for a shot. Come out the weak side, have your forward carry it up the half wall like he's under control. When he hits the hash mark, leave the wall open, have the D go down and drop it. That'll teach the cycle on your D. It'll teach you low to high passes on your D. It'll have your forwards using the back of the net. So it's a really simple drill that can help your offense and use the other side and generate offense and bring your points into play. And the other one I mentioned is just a 3-on-2, like, you know, on entries. Just get a puck. Just line up. I mean, we have enough players where we can do 3-on-2 continuous from one end to the other. But just get that puck into your centerman's hand. Tell your defenseman to stay between the dots. Drive with speed through the neutral zone. Distribute the puck to either side. Drive into the zone and pick your option. Either shoot it, hit the centerman driving through the net, or hit the weak side forward on the side of the ice. And that'll help establish your identity for what you do in 3-on-2. But this drill here, I do it all the time. I've done it for years, all the time, because I really think so. What you saw in the video isn't by chance. It's worked on, and a lot of it came from this and this drill here. So I hope it gives you guys some success as well. I'm not sure if you guys have questions for me. I'm more than happy to take some questions here. That's the end of my presentation that I have.
We got a lot.
All right.
Here we go. All right, unfortunately, I know Peter's got to get to the airport too, so I don't know how many of these we'll have time for. But most important, I think you could probably write some cliffhangers, you know, for HBO or something, because several people want to know, did your son make the team?
Yeah. He ended up making, that's the funniest story. I tell that story. Good thing none of you guys were putting that on your phone and getting it out to social media, so that's good. embarrassing moments for me. He ended up making the AAA team. So my boys are at Proctor Academy in New Hampshire right now. It's a prep school that plays in that New England prep circuit. They've really enjoyed it there. Back then, he ended up making the AAA team. It was a team out of Raleigh, and he had fun. It was a good year for him. But yeah, he ended up making the team.
That's the good news.
Despite his father, he ended. So the ending of the story is he ends up making the team. He was so excited he came out of the locker room, and you know, I was so mad that he said that to that mom that I couldn't even think about him making the team. I couldn't wait to get him in the car and yell at him. I'm like, what are you doing? What are you saying? Right, but he ended up making the team.
Real quick, when you join a team as a new coach, do you tailor your style or systems to players or make them learn your style or system?
I think, again, as a coach, you come up with who you are. You're going to figure that out. And none of this happened overnight. Like, this is years of me trying to figure out what's the best way to make things happen and what do I like. And I want to be aggressive. I don't want to be a one-man forecheck. I don't want to not take chance and not look to seek to win the game as opposed to defend the game. And the championships have been won both ways, but I've been down a road, I think, with how I want to play and how I want a team to play. If I were to take on, which I have, a team for USA, I would try to do this exactly. I would try to do my neutral zone. I would try to implement this offensively. I would try to do it if I went and coached a peewee team. Which I have sometimes when I've been fired. I've gone and worked I've coached my kids, and I've tried to put these things in place. So for me, it's more about what I believe in and how I think a team can be successful and doing my best to practice through repetition. And again, the reason why I like that video clip of Denzel Washington, it's not about how much you throw at the kids. It's just about how well they know what they're doing. If they go out on the ice and they know what they're doing and they believe in what they're doing, you have a chance to win any game. But they have to know that.
All right, I know we got to let you go. You got to rush off to the airport here.
What time is it?
Peter Laviolette. It's about 3:15.
I can take a couple more.
Got a couple more? Yeah. Okay. All right. I'm getting hand signals from the gallery here.
Unless
I'm like,
you don't have any more.
No, there's a whole bunch.
Right, go ahead. I'll be quick.
This one came in real quick, and it should be a quick one, but apparently there's something good here. What should coaches eat or drink for a pregame?
Way too much. The Never Hungry League, the National Hockey League. So we eat like we're players still. You know what I mean? Like we're going to go out there and burn the calories. But
all right, you know, several of these hit the same kind of thing. As a coach, can you give a little bit of a scenario of what it's like when a trade is made and you have somebody like Weber,
yeah,
that was such a huge part, traded, and yeah, then a big name guy in Subban coming back in? How, yeah, you manage that scenario?
Well, it's really difficult when something like that happens. Shea Weber is he was the fabric of the Nashville Predators, the captain of the team. If you ever got to meet him, this is a terrific leader and a terrific person. He, in my 2 years there and his whole life probably and career, he's done the right thing. He's the most fit guy every training camp. He went number one in fitness. He practices hard every day. He says the right thing. He's an excellent teammate. He plays the game the way it's supposed to be played. And so these decisions are not easy inside of an organization. And I think through the end of the organization, at the end of the day, through the organization, the decision was made to make a trade for PK Subban. I met him yesterday for the first time since the trade. I've met him before, but got a chance to sit down and talk with him yesterday. He was in Nashville, and terrific guy. He's excited for the opportunity to come here. It's hard to talk about what he's going to bring to the trade, and it always seems to get compared against Shea. He's going to go play for Team Canada in the World Cup, and you know, has won Olympic gold medals, so it's not like I'm comparing the two when I talk about PK. But PK's a terrific player. He's going to bring a dynamic to our team. Plays the game, you know, more like Roman Josi probably, where he's up the ice and moving. He's a terrific skater, terrific distributor. He's got a good shot. Has won a Norris Trophy, so you know we're excited to work with PK as well.
All right, one last one for you. I think this is a great question because when you're talking offense, the way that center drive makes that defenseman vulnerable. They want to know, how do you actually counter that vulnerability when it's coming back at you? So if the other team is coming at you, so go from offense now to defense, the other team's coming over your blue line and they do that center drive, you're looking for the vulnerability when you're on the offense. How do you counter it when it's coming back at you?
Yeah, well, a lot of it goes to what I said. Usually, if we're chasing down a rush and we've only got two defensemen and one tracker back or one reload back, there's a chance that we made a poor decision through the neutral zone or on the offensive zone attack. Don't let your team come out from behind the net and just throw it blind. That will lead to a 3-on-2 going back the other way where you're now vulnerable defensively. If they don't see something that they don't like, continue the push to the corner and up the wall. If you don't like it, go back behind the net again, come out the other side and just continue the grind, and maybe nothing happens. Something doesn't happen every time you're on offense. But if it does turn over, you know, I think the reloads have a lot to do with that, making sure that your first two forwards that are doing the hunting offensively, that they're really working hard to get back in a back-checking manner to try and clog up the middle of the ice so they're not hitting the weak side forward or they're not hitting a late defenseman. 3-on-2s are going to happen. You know, they are.
All right. Folks, Peter Laviolette.
Thank you, guys. Thanks for having me.